Welcome to the control and maintenance aspect of cooling towers. In this particular lecture, we are going to discuss about the various aspects pertaining to the control measures of the cooling tower. Now, before we go into the detail, let's have a look at what we have discussed in the previous lecture. We discussed about the components and materials pertaining to the cooling tower. In this, we discussed about the drift eliminators, we discussed about the water distribution profiling of cooling tower. Then we had a discussion about the cold water basin, which is an integral part of the cooling tower. Then different types of fans and fan drives. Apart from this, because the materials in the cooling tower play a very vital role, so we discussed about the material aspect in the manufacturing of cooling tower. And then we discussed about the various application attributed to the cooling tower. Now, in this particular lecture, we are going to discuss about the controls in cooling tower, because you know the controlling aspect in any kind of operation or any kind of equipment is quite essential. So, when we talk about the cooling tower and its importance, then the control in the cooling tower is equally important. So, in this particular lecture, we are going to discuss about the start and stop control of cooling tower, then how we can control the capacity of the cooling tower, this will be we will discuss. Then we will discuss about the fan speed concept of with respect to the control in the cooling tower. Then make up water control, how we can make up, because in the previous lectures we discussed about that the make up water play a very vital role in the cooling tower efficiency. So, we will discuss that how to make up and how to control the make up water. Then we will discuss about the Ligionella control, then scale and corrosion deposit falling and microbiological falling, etcetera. Then lastly, we will discuss about the maintenance aspect in the cooling tower. So, let us start with the start and stop control. Now, this is the first step in controlling the operation of cooling tower, that is turn it on or off when needed. Now, this particular operation is quite important in the cooling tower, because it ultimately starts any kind of operation and it also stops the any kind of cooling tower operation. So, the starting and stopping, they are controlled by the electrical interlock with chiller. So, that the tower is allowed to operate at any time with chiller is in operation. The interlock first starts the condenser water pump to establish the flow, and then the actual tower operation is controlled by the capacity control scheme, whatever applied to that particular cooling tower. Now, in multi-tower or multi-cell common condenser water system, start stop control is an integral part of capacity control system of the cooling tower. Now, the initial system startup, this can create a problem if system has been shut down overnight in the spring and fall, and the condenser water temperature in the tower basin may be below say 65 degree Fahrenheit. Now, if this particular cold water circulate to the condenser, the chiller may shut down by safety control due to low condenser water temperature. Now, in this case, chiller will not start until the condenser water temperature is increased above say 65 degree Fahrenheit. To prevent this, a modulating three-way control valve should always be used with cooling tower system. Now, the control valve is open to bypass, thus on startup all condenser water flow bypasses the tower and circulate through the condenser. So, when chiller loads, the condenser begins to reject heat to the water and raising its temperature. So, this is the basic phenomena. Now, as the water temperature raises to a set point say up to say 70 to 75 degree Celsius, control valve modulates the bypass closed and diverting water to the tower, and tower capacity control scheme takes over. The bypass control valve should be placed close to the condenser as possible, and it must also be at an elevation or below the tower basin if bypass line is connected to condenser water supply line. Now, sometimes if chiller and condenser water pump shut down at night, The bypass port reopens and water in the bypass line will drain to same level as tower water level. Now, sometimes this results in air gap or bubble in the bypass, and when start up in the next morning, these bubbles they may enter into the pump and causing to it to lose prime, because these air bubbles creates a problem, and it may create a problem that the pump may lose its prime. So therefore, sometimes it may require the priming. Now all flow will stop and causing the chiller to shut down. So all these things are interlinked all together. So the bypass line must be piped to the tower basin. Now if valve cannot be installed below the tower operating water level, therefore when the drain down will occur, the resulting air bubble cannot enter into the pump. So the proper bypass valve installation, it should be located or it should locate the valve close to the condenser. The valve and all piping should be below the tower water operating level. The valve bypass should be piped directly to the condenser water supply. Now here you see that this figure shows the bypass valve installation, that is a chiller piping, this is a chiller piping and pump located below the tower basin. Now here you see that this is the tower basin, below the tower basin level, and these are the bypass control valve. Similarly, this particular figure shows that the bypass valve installation, the chiller and chiller piping, this is the chiller piping and the pump, they are located at the same level of the tower basin. Now let us talk about the capacity control. Now the capacity can be controlled with condenser water temperature controlled by manipulation of air flow through the tower. Now if the condenser water temperature becoming too cold, the tower capacity must be reduced to maintain the condenser water supply temperature set point. Now it is a better practice to maintain the condenser water supply temperature control set point as 70 to 75 degree Fahrenheit. Now fan speed control. The condenser water supply temperature could be controlled by changing the fan speed. Now 10% rise above set point of the condenser water supply temperature would result in 10% increase in the fan speed and therefore the proportional control. A proportional integral, or sometimes referred as PI control mode, is recommended for fan speed control. The proportional integral derivative, sometimes referred as PID, the PID control mode should be avoided, since derivative function tends to create more problem that it solves. The makeup water control. It is controlled by monitoring the tower basin water level. There are two type of devices being used. One is the mechanical float valve. Now this is the simple float operated valve that modulate open to add water as float falls with the water level and modulate close as float rise. Now these valves are not accurate and reliable due to the regular maintenance requirement. Now second is the electronic level sensor. The sensor has four probes that detect the water level in the basin, such as high water level alarm, high operating water level, low operating water level and low water level alarm. So when the water level drops the low operating level, then a signal opens solenoid valve to add water to the system, and when level rises to high operating level, then a signal closes to makeup valve. Now scale and its control. Scale is again very crucial aspect in cooling tower operation, And you know that the main constituent of scale is calcium carbonate. The process of scale formation starts with the nucleation with a few atoms, form an orderly arrangement and develops into a crystal shape of scale forming substances. The solution should be alkaline for scale formation, that is a pH greater than 7 in case of acid conditions which causes corrosion. The compound such as calcium and magnesium bicarbonates, carbonate and sulfates, they are present in the water which causes scale formation. Now, these compounds, when the solubility is reached, form the hard crystalline layer of scale on the surface with which the water is in contact. Now, the scale formation can be controlled by conversion of these bicarbonates or carbonates into more soluble form by using the acid. But the use of acid in excess may cause the corrosion, and that is again a very difficult aspect. Now, another method is base exchange softening process, which will remove all the main source of scale, but this particular method is quite expensive. So, you need to look the cost factor too. The problem with the base exchange softening process is the deterioration of the timber due to high pH, the lignin is leached out of the timber. Now, to avoid such condition in this particular method, the continuous monitoring of pH level with automatic dosing of the acid by signal obtained from the pH meter. Now, let us talk about the corrosion and its control. Now, it is an electrolytic phenomena in the same way as electrolytic cells with an anode, a cathode and electrolytic solution. The dissolved salts in the water gives electrolytic solution and the anode and cathodes are formed in the metal structure of different part. The electron will flow from the positively charged anode and the metal will go into the solution and therefore it may corrode. Now at anode the iron metal dissolves and yield into the positively charged ion and electrons like Fe2+ +2 electrons. Now at cathode the negatively charged OH- ions are formed like O2+4 electrons plus twice H2O and that is 4 OH minus. Now in the electrolyte Fe2+ +2 OH- they form FeOH whole twice. The corrosion can be avoided by blocking the electrolytic action by surface treatment of steel used in construction and by the close control of manufacturing process. Now, to block the electrolytic action, there are two main steps. One is anodic. In this method, the anode is protected by oxide film and typically oxides of chromates, nitrates, orthophosphates, silicates and tannins. The cathodic use of inhibitors which interfere with the oxygen reduction at the cathodic corrosion sites by formation of protective film. So, a protective film is being formed so that this corrosion can't take place. Now, let us talk about the deposits and its control. Sometimes dust and debris they may create a problem to the effective operation of cooling tower. So, the dust and particulate matter from the pollution and the industrial processes, they are get deposited in pockets where the water velocity is very low. It may also arise as the problem of microbiological growth and again it can create and further growth of this microorganism may hamper the efficiency of cooling tower. The chemical agent named as dispersant and sometimes it is referred as lignosulfonates, they are used to assist to keep these deposits suspended in the water so that the concentration can be controlled by purging. Now, carboxymethyl cellulose compounds and synthetic polymers such as polyacrylates and polymethyl methacrylates, they are used as dispersant. Falling and its control. any of the deposits which can form on the metal surfaces such as scale, corrosion and deposit. Now, this is the result of using water which is contaminated with silt, mud, or because leaks in the process may permit the introduction of oily deposits or organic matter. This may also cause microbiological growth. Now, there are various approaches being used in dealing with the fouling. One is that one may use the surfactant. The aim of surfactant is to disperse or emulsify the oily contaminants. Another approach is the use of dispersant. This is to prevent the accumulation of different type of sludge. Then use of coagulants. This may convert the dispersed solid matter into a coherent jelly-like mass. Then use of antifoams. The forming occurs due to excess use of chemicals or biocides and high concentration of contaminants. Now, this can be reduced by using antifoam chemicals. Those are available very much. Let's talk about the microbiological fouling. The makeup water of the cooling system may contain some kind of microorganism. Now, there are some areas in the cooling tower where the temperature will be ideal for the rapid growth of microorganism. Now, some kind of nutrients such as phosphates, hydrocarbons and ammonia, which encourage the proliferation. Now, these organisms may be classified like algae, bacteria, fungi, molds, etc. Now, the algae are green or blue-green in color and dependent on the photosynthesis. They are found mostly in the exposed area of cooling tower, open ponds and dead materials. Algae results in the production of the scale by absorbing carbon dioxide from the water, thus breakdown of soluble bicarbonates to yield the insoluble carbonates and which deposits as scale. Bacteria develops rapidly in dark, and if not checked time to time, it will block the system with or without the help of algae in the same manner as algae do. Now, here you see that the corrosion built up and biosludge deposits in the shell and tube heat exchanger. You see that these dark, now this is a very, you can say, alarming situation. Now, the both bacteria and algae, they prevent inhibitors to forming protecting film on metal surface and hence encourage the electrolytic corrosion. Anaerobic bacteria, also known as sulfate reducers or iron bacteria, they are present in the natural water supply. Now, these attacks on steel and producing pitting corrosion. Fungi can also produces the same effect, but it is less usual to do so. There are need of liquid treatment by using a shock dose to water in tower pond. The shock doses for the interval of 3 or 7 days are sufficient to maintain the control. The presence of nutrient material and the process temperature condition, this may produce a favorable condition for the growth of microorganism. Therefore, to overcome this particular situation, there is a need of increasing the frequency and strength of shock doses. The primary method of controlling the biological fouling is to keep the cooling tower clean at least twice the cooling season. The tower should be drained, scrubbed, clean and allowed to fully dry before refilling. Another method is the chemical treatment to control the microbiological fouling. There are two kind of antimicrobial chemicals or biocides used in cooling tower water treatment. One is oxidizing, another one is non-oxidizing. Let's talk about the oxidizing chemicals. Now, these includes the chlorine, bromine and ozone, which accept the electron from the other chemical compounds. Now, these chemicals are used as antimicrobial, reacted directly with microbes and degrade cellular structure or deactivate internal enzyme system. They penetrate the cell wall and disrupt the cell metabolic system to kill it. The oxidizing chemicals like chlorine can react with steel, stainless steel, and cause rapid corrosion. So the concentration of chloride, it should be less than say 0.7 ppm or it should be very minimum. Non-oxidizing chemicals. Now these chemicals includes isothiazolines, glutaraldehyde, mercaptobenzothiazole, and polyquat. Now these attacks the cells and damages the cell membrane or use energy of the cell, resulting its death. Sometimes it is also known as surface active biocides. Now let's talk about the Legionnaires disease. Now, it was first identified in 1976 in American Legion Convention in Philadelphia. It is a form of pneumonia due to the presence of bacterium in domestic and industrial water system. Many of these strains are considered as harmless, but few of them, such as sero group, it is virulent and constitutes the major hazard to health or life. Not properly designed, maintained and installed cooling tower leads to outbreak of these diseases. Now this is present in all natural water sources, but requires a critical level of concentration of sero group before it becomes a serious hazard to health and life. The bacteria thrives at 37 degrees Celsius and less active if temperature falls below or above it. Iron oxides play a significant role in enabling the bacterium to thrive. The source of infection are calorifiers, cooling towers, hot water system, but the transmission of the, to the lungs occur through spray as in the shower or in the form of drift of cooling tower. The temperature of 70 degrees Celsius is sufficient to prevent the risk of infection, but at this temperature there is a risk of scalding. Now reduction the risk of infection. Now how we can reduce the risk of infection, and that is the concept of this particular subheading. Use of modern correctly fitted drift eliminators is the one way. To minimize the risk of aerosol, ventilation system should be provided in the location of cooling tower. Use of modern PVC packing, which should be demountable and accurately fitted into the tower. Good design of cooling tower by using the glass fiber, coated steel or stainless steel to minimize the corrosion. Provide a quick release hinged door to facilitate the cleaning of tower and cold water basin. Avoid any kind of spray nozzle when towers are in sensitive location. Filtration, water treatment and maintenance and disinfection process is likely to prove the most effective approach in this particular regard. Let's talk about the foam control. Due to contamination present in the ambient air, oxidation of organic by oxidizing antimicrobial chemicals and overfeed to the surfactant added to the reduced filming in cooling tower basin. The condensing water have surface foam that depends on the surface energy of the condensing water. Now this foam can be can interfere with heat transfer and contaminating the area in the drift. Some kind of anti-foam chemicals may be added to control the foam, this including the oil, water soluble organics, silicon compounds, etc. Now water treatment is again very crucial aspect in the cooling tower. So let's talk about the water treatment control system. The automatic condenser water treatment method is highly recommended in comparison to the manual treatment. The automatic condenser water treatment control system must control four elements like blowdown cycle of concentration, deposition inhibitors, corrosion inhibitors and antimicrobials. Now here you see the typical cooling tower water treatment system and its component. Here you see that this is the cooling tower lines. injection heaters, etc. And there are various components are enlisted for the treatment of cooling water. Now, for amount of blowdown to control, there is a need of maintaining specific conductivity set point for condenser water, and the conductivity of the water is a function of amount to dissolve solids. The blowdown is start with opening of a solenoid valve on the condenser water return line. Now, it is controlled by the continuous bleed, that is modulates the control valve by opening and closing a two piston valve to maintain the conductivity within established high and low limits. The injection of deposition, corrosion inhibitors and dispersants, they are fed in proportion to make up water or blow down water flow rate. Two kinds of antimicrobial, like oxidizing and non-oxidizing, they are alternatively fed on a fixed time schedule or feed continuously together to shock the system. Let's talk about the maintenance in the cooling tower. One is the general maintenance. The general conditions of the tower should be checked at each of the inspection and identified any kind of deterioration of protective finishes. Also, whether any external environmental factors have effect on the tower condition. Sometimes like excessive dust or grims or another type of emissions from nearby industrial process. Drive systems. In this system, fan, pumps or pump motors, belt, gear drives, bearing and control gears, etc. maintenance are included. Also, noise and vibration produced from these devices and other devices such as belt, tension, pulley guards, bearing lubrication and free rotation of the fan. Eliminators. Now, in this section, falling, slime and scale buildup are checked and cleaned as per the requirement, and the check whether it is correct sealing into the tower. If there is a loss of 0.001 to 0.005%, there is a need for replacement. Packing. We discussed about packing, and the packing plays a very vital role in any kind of cooling tower operation. So, if you are using the PVC type, then the PVC types of packing is more commonly used in the cooling tower, or you can say it is being used universally, and it should be checked for built up of any kind of debris and cleaned if needed. And if we are using the timber packing, then they also need to be checked for buildup of scale, check for any kind of fungal attack or fungal formation, and these timbers should be replaced if decayed. Then water distribution system. Now, there is a need of periodic thorough cleaning and disinfection of the water system. Also, there is a requirement of clean all the debris, inspect cold water basin, clean basin strainer. Inspect heat transfer surfaces for falling, inspect water distribution pipe work and valves. If there is a difficulty in the cleaning of cold water basin, sometimes maybe because of upturned flanges or inaccessibility, then recess consideration should be given to modify, or sometimes you may go for replacing it. The tower structure. For a steel body of the tower, the protective finish should be checked at a regular interval to protect from corrosion. The timber tower should be checked or damaged of coping, handrails, staircase or evidence of rot due to leakage. Concrete tower require inspection at every year. The tower should be thoroughly cleaned without the need of maintenance. The structure fixing bolts should be inspected for the evidence of corrosion and replace them if necessary with corrosion resistant bolts. So, in this particular lecture, we have discussed about the various control aspects of cooling tower. We discussed a lot because these cooling tower requires a lot of things like cold water basin, different type of pump, valves, etc. And they need to be checked frequently. So we have discussed all the aspects which are essential for smooth functioning of cooling tower. For your convenience, we have listed a couple of references you may go through if you require further reading. Thank you very much.